Welcome to Cheese Paradise.
This is where the magic topping is created that makes every dish just better. Literally, I challenge you to name a dish that it can't improve.
Mac and cheese, cheese on pizza, cheese fondue, and yes, slices on bread. I've been eating loads of it ever since I tried cutting down on meat, but...
To make cheese, you need milk. And to make milk, you need animals that emit loads of greenhouse gas emissions and use lots and lots of water.
I mean, I really love cheese, but we need to talk about it. How hard is this piece of art really on the environment? Do I need to stop eating cheese, and are the alternatives any better?
And the best way to find out, make some cheese yourself. Cheesemakers Paul and Eula have agreed to let me look over their shoulder for the day. First off, we need to get some milk from a nearby farm in Berlin's countryside. Paul used to work for large-scale dairy operations, but gave it up to create his own cheese. And here comes the milk. We just need a couple of minutes for about 250 liters.
How many liters do you actually need to make 1 kilogram of cheese?
That depends on the cheese recipe. So it also depends on the composition of the milk. We're quite lucky here. We are working with milk from Jersey cows. These cows produce milk with very high solids, so we get much better yields than we'd see if we were using Holsteins, for example. But as a general rule, for something like a cheddar or a gouda, we'd probably be looking at a 10% yield. So for every 1 kilo of cheese, you need 10 liters of milk.
And the amount of milk that is used is actually extremely important, because depending on which study you're looking at, between 80 and 95% of cheese's greenhouse gas emissions come from the milk. So the more milk you use, the worse for the planet.
More than half of those emissions come from the farming process, because cows and other milk-producing animals fart and breathe out methane, a gas that is 84 times more potent than CO2 at heating the planet.
But milks from different kind of animals have different carbon footprints.
Cow and buffalo milk have the lowest, with 2.8 and 3.4 kilograms of CO2 per kilogram of milk. Goat and sheep milk's impact is more than double that, with 5.2 and 8.4 kilograms of CO2.
So bigger animals pollute the planet less per kilogram of milk. That's because cows or buffaloes just produce more milk than a goat or sheep, for example.
And because all these animals are ruminants and pump out methane, cheese's carbon footprint is actually bigger than that of poultry and even pork. More emissions than meat? That is absolutely insane. But anyway, now that we got the milk, we need to heat it up and add some bacteria. The goal today, turning this into a yummy soft cheese. And let me tell you, it's boiling in here.
This cheese is particularly happy if the room is a little bit too hot for the cheesemaker. So if you're having a hard time and you feel like you're in a sauna, this cheese is gonna love it.
All right.
What we're starting here is a process called fermentation. The bacteria feast on the sugar that's in the milk and break it down. After a while, we add a liquid called rennet. This is what turns our concoction into cheese, as it restructures the casein in it, a protein that can only be found in animals' milk. And yes, it really works. Our milk is suddenly solid.
Ooh, this is like really different from the milk I know. Oh yeah, it's like my hand is in there.
Just for me to cut it into pieces again.
And suddenly you realize that 200 liters of milk can be quite heavy.
Now we have to work quickly. The curd needs to go into these molds while it's still warm and be flipped after a couple of minutes.
I have no idea if I can do this. Okay, so basically like that.
It's like this?
Yeah. Ah, okay.
Then you turn it around.
Right, and then put it back in.
And you...
It'll cost you 20 euros for every cheese you drop on the floor.
Pressure is on.
Okay, so basically...
Wow!
Oh my God!
After another 2 or 3 hours, all of these molds go into the ripening room, a cheesemaker's treasure chamber.
There are all sorts of cheeses compared to these that need to age for longer periods of time, from 1 or 2 months to even up to 3 years, like the famous Parmesan.
The processing accounts for between 2 to 18% of cheese's final CO2 emissions. But of course, the longer you need to keep it at a certain temperature and humidity for it to become really tasty, the more energy it uses. And now it's cheese tasting time.
So there's some yeasty notes, a really buttery quality.
That's cheesy, but also really mild. Like, it's not really strong taste.
Extremely yummy though.
So to a certain extent, it's better for the planet to eat mozzarella instead of Parmesan and to go for cow's milk options instead of cheeses that are produced from sheep or goat milk. But there are other players on the market that can further reduce your carbon footprint, vegan cheeses. But they might not be as environmentally friendly as you think.
New day, another cheesemaker. But today we're producing the vegan alternative. And here cashews are the main ingredient.
So, das hier sind die Rohstoffe, aber wie wird aus diesen Kernen ein Käse?
Ja, das ist das Wunderbare an Cashewkernen. Wir können aus Cashewkernen eine schöne Milch herstellen. Die werden eingeweicht, dann werden die gesäubert, zerkleinert und es wird wirklich wie eine richtige sämige Milch, die dann weiterverarbeitet werden kann. Genauso wie bei der normalen, richtigen tierischen Käseherstellung zu Käsealternativen.
And after I've ground down all these cashews, bacteria cultures will be added to start the fermentation process, just like you would when making cheese from animal milk. Here we use cashew, but that's not the only alternative.
There are all sorts of ingredients for cheese alternatives. Cashews, almonds, oats, soy, and even olive oil. And because of all these different ingredients and an abundance of different recipes, it's quite hard to calculate the greenhouse gas emissions, water and land use of vegan cheese alternatives.
Vegan cheeses are fairly new, so there aren't a lot of studies on their environmental impact yet, which is why we can only compare what it takes to grow the most popular ingredients. Cashews, almonds, and the new kid on the block, oats. The Dutch National Institute for Public Health and the Environment compared different environmental impacts. Other studies claim different impacts, but for easy comparison, I'm sticking to this one. Just growing the ingredients for some cheese alternatives already uses more water than producing a whole cheese. But making cheese emits way more CO2 than with vegan alternatives.
But what's important to remember is that it doesn't take 1 kilogram of cashews, almonds or oats to make 1 kilogram of cheese alternative. Here, we only use 0.5 kilogram of cashews to make 1 kilogram of cheese alternative.
And when you compare that to the 10 liters of milk you need to produce about 1 kilogram of cheese, it's pretty clear why the greenhouse gas emissions of alternatives are just way lower. Once the bacteria have started their work during the fermentation process, the herbs and spices are added. This version is what the company calls chakalaka. To become as delicious as possible, it goes through a similar ripening process as real cheese, where the bacteria continue their work. To help them, these cheeses need to be flipped every once in a while.
Die Cashewbäume in Vietnam werden hauptsächlich in trockenen Gebieten angebaut, weil die Wurzeln sehr, sehr tief ins Erdreich reichen und auch das Erdreich befestigen.
Looking at the science though, it takes quite a lot of water to grow cashews. The Dutch study found water consumption to be as high as 2,000 liters per kilogram of cashews. But it's not just the number that's important. The impact depends a lot on the region where the cashews are grown. Does it rain a lot or is it a water-scarce region, for example? In Vietnam, cashews are mainly grown in areas with relatively little water stress, but the opposite is generally true for Brazil or Burkina Faso. Alrighty, and now I'm really curious how that is going to taste.
Oh, yeah, it has, you smell and taste a lot of herbs. The consistency is actually pretty similar to like cream cheese, but with your herbs and stuff, it's really, really great. All right. That was pretty good, even for a cheese lover. But real cheese just is a little bit better in taste. But looking at it environmentally, bottom line, the alternatives are always better. You have to look a little bit at what exactly is in them and how much of it. If you want to go full out on saving the planet, go for oat-based options. But they are just starting to hit the supermarket shelves now.
Real cheese will always be my number one, but I'll try to switch it up with some tasty alternatives.
That's it from Cheese Fanatic Kai. If you did like the video, please share it and subscribe to our channel with the bell so you don't miss any videos. We post new ones every Friday on The Environment.